Hello there. Let's suppose you are Microsoft and you are releasing a huge and awesome model. How do you make it obvious it is the best, the biggest, the real thing? Correct. You compare your numbers of parameters against the literature, make a beautiful plot where you are the top of the line. So congrats, now everybody is hailing you like you're the best of the best. And you might as well be. Miss Coffee Bean is not here to claim otherwise. But what does the number of parameters tell us about a model anyway? We came across a paper that tells us about a bigger picture. It argues that the number of parameters alone is not enough to compare against other models, and that reporting one number only about a model can be highly misleading when it comes to describing its efficiency. In other words, a high number of parameters does not necessarily mean that the model has high capacity, nor that it is slow. So get ready to get your mind enlarged as we welcome you to this AI coffee break. Thanks to Aleph Alpha for sponsoring this video. Stick around until the end of the video to learn more about them. Model comparisons. What is this all about? Well, we need to measure scientific progress in deep learning. One line of doing so is to measure the model's quality on specific tasks or benchmarks and to measure how much of a sensible output the model delivers. But we do not talk about this today, nor does this paper, because today is all about model efficiency, which relates to how much training a model costs, how much one has to pay to run inference for many users, and how long a user has to wait until the model delivers the answer. To describe model efficiency, the literature uses things like, we cite, the number of trainable parameters, the number of floating point operations, and speed throughput. But the point of this paper is that if one chooses the right cost indicators, one can create a more favorable picture for the model's efficiency than it is in reality, and that the model comparisons relying on only some of these metrics can result in unfair and incomplete comparisons. This is what the authors call the efficiency misnomer. In other words, to avoid the current situation where people are just choosing the metric they shine at and ignore the others, the authors propose that, well, all metrics should be reported when it comes to comparing architectures in general. But what are these metrics, and why does one measure alone not suffice to describe the computational cost of the model? Why is Miss Coffee Bean's secret model of 530 billion and one parameter not automatically the best of the best, and also not necessarily the slowest, since it reportedly, but don't fact check this, has the most parameters in the world? Well, let's look at the efficiency measure of floating point operations, or FLOPs in short, that is frequently used to measure the computational cost in literature. The more operations you have to do, the more computations there need to be executed by a piece of hardware. But as the authors point out, we cite, a model with low FLOPs may not actually be fast, given that FLOPs does not take into account information such as the degree of parallelism or hardware-related details like the cost of a memory access. So supposing that model A has a lower number of flops than the model B, it might as well be that model B is not more efficient because the floating point operations are not executed in sequence, like in a recurrent neural network, but in parallel, all at the same time, like in a transformer. Or even more, maybe model B is better suited for the hardware it runs on and, for example, memory access is faster for model B than for model A. So even though model A has lower flops than B, model B could be much more computationally efficient. Then let's look at the number of trainable parameters in a model, which is also a widely used measure for efficiency. But the authors here draw the attention to the fact that very few trainable parameters can still be very slow, especially when the same parameters are used in the same computation, like it is the case with convolutions in CNNs and with the feedforward layers in transformers, where the same feedforward network, so the same parameters, are used for each token, as we discussed in a previous video. So, while the number of parameters from the fully connected layer does not increase with the sequence length for transformers, the compute and memory definitely do, because all these outputs for each feedforward layer have to be computed and stored in memory. The authors highlight that the number of parameters of a model is a good proxy for knowing whether the model fits in the memory, but cannot be a cost indicator, or not alone. Also, the number of parameters is often used to imply the capacity of the model in the sense of its expressive power of capturing complex function and dependencies between input and output, which is not necessarily true, because parameter sharing, which reduces the effective number of parameters, does not necessarily decrease the model expressivity. Just think about it. If we would remove the parameter sharing in transformers and each token would have its own feedforward neural network with its own parameters, which would make the number of parameters increase linearly with the sequence length. Would that increase the accuracy of the model, and would that model necessarily learn a better function? No, it wouldn't, not necessarily. I mean, we would have n position-specific feedforward neural networks instead of just one, but it's questionable that this would model anything better or that it would even converge with the data amounts we have currently, because we would have removed an important inductive bias of the transformer, which is that every token is treated the same, modulo what the attention scores dynamically computed beforehand. And yes, it does look like increasing the number of parameters also increases the model accuracy and quality. But this again, it is just an impression we get, because the increase of number of parameters usually comes with an increase in training data and with some specific architecture changes. So no, it's not just about the number of parameters, but also about the architecture and its inductive biases, the data, again the data, and then all the training gimmicks, of course. Other metrics like throughput and speed, which relate to how much a user has to wait for the model to give an answer, strongly depend on hardware and sometimes simply on the skill of the programmer who implemented the whole thing and does not necessarily speak of an architecture on itself. So this measure, again, if used on its own, is not a fair comparison between models. And let's follow the paper a little closer and dive into the discrepancy between training and inference scenarios that adds a whole new dimension to the discussion. Depending on context, training, inference, or even both can be more important to look at. For example, Miss Coffee Bean might not have the data, the compute, or enough money to pay the electricity bill of the TPUs and GPUs that Microsoft and Google and other likes have to train a huge model on billions of data samples. But she does have enough VRAM to load the model and fine-tune it on more tasks. This is one of the appealing aspects of the pre-train and fine-tune paradigm, that one general-purpose model is trained just once, and the environmental damage is done only once, and its training cost, we cite, can be very small compared to the inference cost when a model is deployed to be used by many, many users. But in cases where retraining has to be done very often, like it is the case with recommender systems that have to be kept up to date with the user preferences and available content at any moment, the training cost can become very important again. On the other hand, if the inference efficiency is the bottleneck because the deep learning-based application runs on mobile phones, then the inference speed is very important. So we have seen now how different measures can disagree when it comes to describing efficiency for the same model, and that one measure of efficiency alone can be highly misleading. Also, the number of parameters alone is not a measure for much else than how large a storage the model needs, and that the more efficiency metrics a paper reports, the better, especially to be sure that nobody misses out on the unfavorable metrics. And speaking of companies that have the means to crunch the numbers for really large models, let's introduce our sponsor Aleph Alpha. Aleph Alpha's vision is quite simple: to be the leading European company researching and creating next generation strong artificial intelligence. Think of it as a Europe's open AI, but then forget this again, as it puts a European twist to it. I love this. A little bit of competition in AI from Europe will benefit everyone, no? Aleph Alpha's European approach and datasets have an impact beyond poor language understanding. This means they're going multimodal. So what they do best at Aleph Alpha is research and development in AI with a European focus. They have a diverse team of currently more than 30 senior experts from all relevant fields, working relentlessly to create truly transformative AI technology, which shall lead to new ways for human-machine collaboration. Going off script now, I know some of the people working there and they are great. From research to development to implementation, AI must benefit all of society, and that's why Aleph Alpha strives to align modern generalizable AI research sustainably with ethical values. And to achieve that, they search for the best talent and partners. So if you're looking for a job, make sure to check out Aleph Alpha. For more information, visit their website or follow them on Twitter. See the links in the description below. Thanks for watching this episode, and if you enjoyed this, do not forget to tell your own coffee beans about this channel.